Hello, Shirley Adams here with Series 12, Program 7. Silhouettes change every year, and a very popular shape right now is the swing. If you like the idea of this comfortable styling, you can very easily convert any straight cut pattern to a swing. And here's what you must consider. Where are you going to add the flare? Because that makes a big, big difference. Now, I have a pattern down here on the table right now that I'm going to turn into a swing. I don't have it here with me, but this was a pewter raincoat, a leather raincoat that I made on the last series is what this pattern was from. And it was just straight cut, as you can see on the side seam. It just goes straight all the way down. Well, I'm going to flare this. Now, where would you like to add that flare? And that is the most important thing probably about this. There's no way you can just add it right here at the side seam, because if you'd make that flare out, think of what it would look like on your body. There's a little rule here. Wherever you add the extra fabric on the flat, on the table, that's where it's going to flare and it's going to hang that way on your body. And if you would just add it to the side there, you would have this outfit that's perfectly straight, and it would just stick out on the sides and kind of hang down there, and all the folds would be on the side. And that would look a little funny. You really want that flare to be equally flared all the way around, so we have to think, where is the best place to add it? On this one, and what this is when it got all finished, was this green leather coat that's up here. And you can see how there's a little extra here in front. You can see how the folds start from right above the bust, right about here in the middle, and that's usually the place where you want to add flare, right about where the bust is. In other words, in about the middle of the pattern piece. The same thing would apply to the back. I've added it, and you can see by the folds, I've added it here and here, and because of that, it hangs gracefully all the way around, and it kind of flares, and you can see the folds hang equally about all the way around. Now, don't anyone tell her, because this is a big secret. I have a daughter-in-law with a birthday coming up very soon, and this is a birthday present for her. She's going to be delighted because she's been asking me for at least a year, when are you going to do something for me with that green leather, Cheryl? So she's going to be delighted. But what I want to do with this piece on the table is add the flare, same pattern, add it the same place. Now, because this is lightweight fabric, we might go beyond that. This is just a very lightweight microfiber, actually. It's a rayon, I believe, maybe a polyester. But where I'm going to add this is a little bit at the back, a little bit right in the center of the pattern, and maybe even a little bit at the side. The lighter with the fabric, the more flare you can have there, the fuller it can be and still look fine. Now, you've probably seen swings in every fabrication imaginable this year, and that includes everything from heavy melton winter coats to various leathers to anything lightweight. I just recently saw a wonderful lacy beach coat that was a swing. Anything will do in this type of styling. Okay, this pattern that I'm using has a center back seam. So please remember that if you're using a pattern with seams, there isn't a grain arrow that's curved that says cut on the fold. There are a couple of notches here that say there is a 5/8 inch seam here. So for starters, I'm immediately moving it right over 5/8 so that I don't have that seam down the center back, because there's no reason for it. My fabric is plenty wide for what I want to do. Therefore, get rid of that right away, get rid of that seam allowance. What I'm going to do then is just put a pin so it won't move here at the top for a minute, and I'm not actually going to cut this out. I'm going to use it as my chalkboard and chalk on it so that it can just be erased to shake the chalk dust out, and I can go ahead and cut it out for another project sometime. But how I would cut this out is start pivoting right away, and pivoting is what you're going to do when you add flare. This is going to be my first pivot point right up here at the back neckline. So I'll pivot this out a little bit, and what I'm adding here, this would be the stitching line. So I'm adding, oh, approximately 2 inches, because this is a fold of fabric, that'd be 4 inches that I'm adding here to the center back. And what I would do is just put a pin right here. I've already pivoted, and I would just cut out the neckline. I almost grabbed my shears, and I better watch what I'm doing here. Okay, so I would just cut around here. These little chalk wheels are handy to use for things because they give a nice fine line. They don't give a heavy line the way sometimes actual chalk does. So I like to use it for pattern work. And I'm not going to pivot yet, so I'll just start coming down this shoulder line. And this, of course, is a raglan sleeve. So actually, the shoulder line would be up here. This is coming down under the arm. So with this raglan line, I'm going to come down right about to the center of the piece, which is right about here. This would be comparable to right about where the bust is if it would be a front pattern piece. And right here is going to be another pivot point. So I decide at this point where I want it. Now at the same time I'm adding the flare to this, I also am not going to, I believe, on this add any length. I think that I already had this pattern folded up the same as the green leather, so this was the length I wanted it. But it would be a good idea if I would mark this bottom also, because that bottom, notice as I go along, is going to change. Instead of here's where the original bottom is, I'll put a dotted line there, and here's where the side is, just with that little bit of flare added. You can see how that mark changes then as I add the rest of the flare. Okay, I've marked it down right about to the center of the piece, so I'll start here. Here's my second pivot point. I can either put a pin in, or I'm just going to hold my finger on it and pivot it some more. Now right now, here is where it is, and I want to add right here in the midsection, maybe 3 inches or so. So I'll pivot this, and I can see how much I'm adding, both by what I have moved from my original pivot down here, what I've added. I can see how much I've added now to this center part, or I can also see from this little line I made a minute ago how much I've moved since then. And it's approximately 3 inches right now. I'm going to give it a little more. It's a lightweight fabric. So okay, what I've done there is move it about 4 inches now, and I'm going to here on the shoulder just then trace the rest of this. If I wanted any more flare added, I could put another pivot point here, just move it out again and trace around it some more that way. In fact, why don't we just do that? Okay, I'm going to mark where this bottom is right now while I'm here, and then I'll pivot it again. Might as well go out to the edge of the fabric. Okay, now we have really pivoted. You can take so many liberties with this, and it's going to be just fine. It's going to fit you fine. You won't have any problems. As long as this is still going to measure, this shoulder line here, it will still measure exactly the same as it did originally before I started making these moves on it. Okay, putting this out here, and then I just need to trace this side as is, and I could cut it out. And what I also will have to show you here is what has happened to the hemline. Okay, let me take this off and you can see our new piece, and it's going to work out beautifully. There's going to be no problem. It's going to hang perfectly in nice little folds all over. And what I have done, notice, with the hem, as I traced it as I went along, it used to be a perfectly straight line. I could put a yardstick on that and there's no curve at all. But now see how that hemline is rounded? And of course it must be. Anytime you have something flared, you always have a curved hemline, because if you don't, if it would stay straight, it would hang down in a point there on the side. So it must be curved. Well, here we have a pattern piece. I could just use the rest of the pattern as is then, which is what I did on the jacket. The sleeves haven't changed a bit. It's only the front and the back that I did this identical thing to make this swing coat and make it work out that way. Now, what I haven't done yet, but I do have a scrap left over at home, I will make a belt at the same time, just in case. Just in case this style changes and she wants to belt it in, fine, no problem at all. Or you could also, if you wanted to reverse this, take some tucks in it, some seams. If you wanted to straighten it out, it could the following year or 3 years hence, whenever the swing disappears and is no more. There's no reason why it couldn't have some gores in here if you wanted to take out that fullness. It's quite all right. Now, what I have under this coat is a straight skirt, and that's very important. The last time the swing was around, or the last time I was involved in a swing, and maybe it cured me for a while, was back many, many years ago as I was a young woman, and I made the mistake of having a short swing coat, and I made under that a flared skirt, and it looked very, very bad. When you do something wrong, you learn a lesson you never forget. To have that swing on top and then another swing right under it, it looked very funny, like pagoda or something. So don't do that. Anytime you have a full top, then it would look nicer. It would be more flattering to have straight pants, straight skirt, straight something underneath, so it gives a slimmer look. Okay, so very easy, right? You can all do that. Of course you can. Okay, that's one thing we added a swing to. Another thing is the one that I have in back of here, and I'll bring that out to show you. And the way this started out, and I already have a little belt made for this one, the way this one started out is just as an adjustable plastic patterner. And so starting from that with a basic bodice, it doesn't look anything like this. I'll get rid of this pattern and move up a new chalkboard here, move up some more fabric, and do the same thing down here. Okay, there, new length here. Okay, so I'm going to take that adjustable patterner, and what I'm going to do here to make it a little bit easier for you to tell is just show how I traced it on paper, and then after I had it traced, then I can do the same thing with this paper, just because it's a little easier to manipulate. Okay, here's what I originally did with this adjustable patterner. I have it all adjusted so that, you know, all the knobs are tightened up and it's adjusted to my measurements. But I really don't want this fitted bodice, which is what it is. And by the way, what I'm cutting here is the back. So I'm going to put this little template in, which is the neck piece, because the only difference here between the front and the back, the basic unit is the same for both. The only difference, that's true of any pattern, the only difference here, as long as there aren't darts in it, is this neck piece, because the back neck is always about 2 inches or 2.5 higher than the front neckline. If you'll look at yourself sideways in the mirror, you'll notice your neckline also is up higher in back, right about where that bone sticks out at the top of your spine. And your neckline in front is right where that hollow is in your neckline, and that's always about 2 to 3 inches lower. So you can very easily convert back and front by just changing that. One other little conversion here, and I have the back sleeve, I see, or the back sleeve piece. Here, you would change that for making a front pattern because the curves are a little bit different. The front curves in a little bit more than your back does, and so you'd need to make that adjustment too. Well, I'm making a back, so this is on here. Now, I don't want this fitted bodice that the basic pattern always is. It's always a fitted bodice. This one I want to be wider, so after I cut out this much of the pattern, I then brought this out wider, and as I did that, I just brought it down the arm here, the shoulder, and made that a straight line. You could also come out this way, but you'd have to do some adjusting on the shoulder. I decided it was easier to just keep coming out straight, and what that meant is it dropped down lower when it came out straight. That means the underarm also dropped down lower, and that's important. When you have anything that drops off your shoulder, don't try to have a little high, tight arm's eye. It won't work. It's always a more generous cut, and so you need to make sure that comes down lower there so that it will work out just right. As it came down lower here, by the way, it dropped a little lower here. Of course, the whole thing is all in one piece, and so what I have done as I cut it off is drop it down to the lower line and then just kept going straight over to the center. It really didn't matter that much because I'm going to make this longer than it is here in the patterner. I want to add extra length to this, and I'm also going to add flare both back and front. And here, because we don't have raglan sleeves, we'll do it in a little bit different way. What I would do for adding flare to this one then, and before I move this completely off, let me explain something else. Very often when you have dropped shoulders like that, instead of having this rounded arm's eye the way you would have for set-in sleeves, very often you have this one instead. And of course, this is just sort of a straight piece over here, just a square. And when this one goes on with the knobs there, when it adjusts on this way, you can see how the arm's eye would just be out. Picture a t-shirt, a drop shoulder t-shirt, picture something cap sleeve. This is what it looks like. So this is just another alternative by which you can change whatever your shoulder looks like. Okay, I didn't choose to do that. I instead just went out with this to make it a little bit wider. And you can see as you look at this garment that that's what happened. It does come out here instead of being a straight line as some dropped shoulders are. You're the designer. You have that choice, whichever you want it to be. So, okay. I have this one all done. All I need to do is decide when I'm tracing this where to add the flare again. And where I would add it here is probably, now this is, again, lightweight fabric, where I added it on the melon colored one, that's a wool crepe. It's a little bit heavier. I didn't want as much flare there. The reason I made this, by the way, let me tell you, I had a few letters about after the mastectomy, what then? Because there might be some changes, not only in the bust area, but also there might be some changes in maybe one arm retains a little more fluid than the other and could be larger. But I had letters from several career women saying, I don't feel comfortable in a suit. What can I wear that really looks professional? You'll see this in a little bit on a model, and it does look professional to have this solid color, to have a blouse under it, to have the whole suit. It's very lightweight. There is no lining. It's just one layer. So it's very comfortable. It's free, and it would be perfect for that. It would also make a great maternity top. There are all sorts of ways or reasons to wear it. Okay, with this one, though, we're going to, again, trace the center back. I have it transposed the other way. I'll just turn it over. It really doesn't make a bit of difference. There is not a seam allowance here. Therefore, I just consider this the fold right here in back. Here again, you always have to make the decision. Do I want something right at the back? Maybe a little bit. So you'd go ahead and trace up that far. But this one, in addition, I want it to be longer. So since I want it to be, oh, let's say about 8 inches longer, I will not only mark up here at the top and mark, I'll just leave it at that. I'm going to mark my extra 8 inches down here, and then I'll pivot maybe a little bit from this point. So you can pivot as many times as you want to. Just be sure you don't add it all out at the side, or then you will be sorry. Won't look nice. Okay, my 8 inches, I'll just keep moving the ruler along and make that line also 8 inches wider. Trace this down in probably, again, about the middle of the shoulder is where I would like to pivot mainly. That's going to be the biggest pivot because you want those folds hanging kind of on each side to match and to look just right. So I'm going to pivot this right here at the center shoulder. And then we're going to compare in a minute what that shoulder looks like from what it used to be. Okay, if I put another mark here, and I'll finish drawing the line of this shoulder and go ahead and finish up the rest of it and mark it out here. By the time I add my 8 inches, wherever they come out, it's probably going to be right about at the edge of the fabric, so this is about all I could add to this to make it work. But just make sure from the original hem you keep adding that 8 inches. And then it's just a matter of follow the dots. Connect that line along there and you have that nice rounded line to cut. So very simple to change this styling. Is it any wonder that I do so many things from a basic at home? Because it's so quick and easy to do and you know it's going to work out. It can't miss. It can't go wrong. Now do notice what happened to the shoulder line here. Instead of the original shoulder line, which was here in a completely straight line, if I'd put my ruler on it, it would be really straight. Now it comes up here a little bit higher, and also it curves a little bit. And the arms I still measures what the original one does, therefore the sleeve will still fit in without any adjustment. We have no problems here at all. The neckline is the same, so the collar is going to fit on. Nothing has changed really, except we've added the flare down at the bottom, and that's all. The one that I'm wearing is made from the very same pattern. And what I did with this one that I'm wearing is decide it doesn't come right out to the edge of my shoulder. It's cut in a little bit. And so there's a little difference there. So when I cut that one out, what I did was, for one thing, cut it down just a little bit, not much. But I cut it down just a little bit, probably about this much in back. And instead of cutting it out wider as this one was, I had the original pattern, which only came to here and down here. And I decided I wanted this a little narrower in the shoulder. So instead of cutting the whole thing, there's no reason why you can't cut it in a little bit narrower there. And while I'm at it, I cut it down a little lower because this is a big long vest, but I wanted it cut out to accommodate whatever big sleeve I would put in here. So that's why I cut the arms eye down lower. Isn't that a simple change? Nothing to it. Now, when I made this one, where I changed as far as pivoting to make that flare is right about in the middle of this shoulder. So this was my pivot point, and this is the only place actually I pivoted on this. So I think I added something like a total of 32 inches to this. the one that I'm wearing, that means I added 8 inches in each of these places. From the original right up to here, I would cut, then I would pivot this over 8 inches and do the rest of it. And by the time I did that to the two back sides and to the two front sides, it made almost a yard extra. So it is quite flared down here and a lot larger than it was before. This also might be a nice comfortable style. If you have a smaller top part of your body and larger hips, it would conceal very nicely and it might be quite flattering. So think about this swing. Now on this I have a double swing actually. Not only is the whole bottom part flared, but notice I have a swing up here on the top also. And notice where this swing starts. This starts right up at the center, right up at the center front. And if I want this as a front, it would be right here. And instead, here is the center front, which is actually right here, I'm sorry. Where I started is right up here at the neckline. And as I cut this out, instead of cutting any neckline at all here in front, what I have done to it is just continue this on up. And I made an arbitrary line. I just decided, oh, from that neck point, I want it to come up here about, what is that, a foot, 8 inches, whatever I have here. I just came straight up the shoulder to that line, the same way as I've done here on the fabric. And then I curved this in, and just sort of curved it in like a lapel, and by the time I got here, it joins the rest of it and goes straight down. So it's just that extra that swings out right there, and that's what you see here. And when you have it undone, it just hangs kind of gracefully in this cascade ruffle. If I would fasten it, where it fastens is in a line straight opposite the neckline over here. And so what I have found with this little frog I've put on the shoulder, I would tie the two together up here, and then this collar forms as it folds over. A lot you can do with this wherever you put the swing. You might put it in a sleeve, you might put it somewhere else, but it's something very, very easy to add. Let's look at the models and see how they look in these things now. And if you see, okay, this first one, the green leather, the swing coat, notice how it flares a little bit. It's heavier fabric. It will someday be belted probably. The next one, the melon-colored one, let's see it both without the belt. Turn around there, will you? And let's see how it swings out. Oh, that's nice. Okay, and then put the belt on and tie it around and see how it looks. Now, we did a tube show a few weeks ago, and this is simply those fabric tubes that we have all put together there and little tips glued on the ends of it so it gets that commercial, that professional look. And then we have something else that I didn't show you on the show, but I received this from someone out in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Nancy Kane, her name is. And this flare is also at the neck. This happens to be a David Dow type construction on the suit jacket. Maybe I'll get to that in another program. It's just one layer throughout. I also get a lot of letters from people who don't sew at all, but watch the show because they enjoy it, and I'm glad if I entertain you. But you might be interested in getting in touch with this organization to find someone who could sew for you if you don't want to sew for yourself. Also, there are those of you who do sew, but your problem is fitting. You might be able to contact a chapter in your area, find out who does the most with fitting, and make an appointment with them to just fit some of your patterns on you so that then you can go back home and on your own do all the sewing that you want to do. So I like to keep you connected with whoever around the country can help you in any way, whether it's products, people, whatever it is. Well, the swing won't stay around forever, perhaps. But when the fashion pendulum swings the other way, you can convert with a belt, so nothing is lost. Belts and several other projects are so much more easily made with the help of fusibles, fusible interfacings, any kind of fusibles. Join me next time for Feasible with Fusibles.